Tonight, the Philippine government issues a level 3 alert for Sudan to pave the way for the voluntary repatriation of Filipinos from the war-torn nation.
Philippine authorities are set to file multiple murder and frustrated murder complaints against suspended lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. for the killing of provincial governor Roel Degamo.
A Philippine court issues a hold departure order for former prison chief Gerald Bantag, a suspect in the murder of broadcaster Percy Lapi.
And a Chinese Coast Guard ship blocks a Philippine patrol vessel in the West Philippine Sea.
Good evening, I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Pia Gutierrez.
On our broadcast tonight, voluntary repatriation now urged for Filipinos in conflict-torn Sudan. That's as a ceasefire of warring military factions there is about to end Thursday. But the U.S. and African nations are trying to get it extended. Zen Hernandez has tonight's top story.
More than 400 have been killed and at least 4,000 wounded from heavy clashes between Sudan's army and a paramilitary unit. Critical infrastructures like hospitals have been wrecked. Food, water, and medical supplies are running out, and chaos have spilled in almost every inch of Sudan's capital, Khartoum, forcing an exodus of civilians. 51 Filipinos have safely reached Egypt. 23 are awaiting clearance at the border. 7 buses of over 300 Filipinos are expected to join them, while another 15 went to the port of Sudan. In an interview on Teleradio, overseas Filipino worker Noemi Sanchez recounted the terrifying experience they had while getting out of Khartoum.
Talagang ini-stop nila, tapos chine-check nila yung mga dala, mga luggage, mga bagahe. Kaya po, yung ibang may mga suot po na mga singsing, mga rilo, oh, mga kwintas, lahat po pinatatanggal kasi yung iba daw pong po sundalo, nangunguha ng mga cellphone, mga pera.
Many Filipinos also lack travel documents, but the Philippine Embassy from Cairo assured nobody will be left behind. The Philippines ambassador to Egypt is now at the Egyptian border to personally oversee the safe entry of Filipinos into Egypt. He and several officials from the embassy are also doing fine after figuring in a car accident on his way to the border.
Kailangan dito ng pre-approval. So yung ating officer na kasama ko dito sa sakyan na nandito din ngayon, nagpaplano kami kung paano siya pupunta sa kabila at mag-issue ng mga passport, okay, mga travel documents.
The Department of Foreign Affairs is also organizing additional buses for Filipinos still left in Khartoum. However, there are others refusing repatriation, including one Filipino who was injured from a stray bullet.
Nandiyan pa siya sa Sudan, ayaw niyang umuwi, ayaw rin niya ng publicity, no? Ganun po, no? So at least okay siya. Bago matapos ang Thursday, buong araw sa Sudan, minus 6 hours, we hope to get one or two more. Kasi meron pa siguro mga 100 plus na gusto umuwi, no? Okay, yung mga gusto manatili doon, well, sanay na raw sila sana sa situation na to.
Meanwhile, Migrant Workers Secretary Susan Ople, together with her undersecretary and labor attachés from Saudi and Morocco, are setting up an assistance center in Aswan, Egypt.
Pagtawid nila sa Egyptian side, kami na yung bahala, transportation, accommodation, pagkain nila yung kailangan ipagamot.
OWA officials are also bound for Egypt to provide financial assistance for Filipino workers, documented or otherwise. Financial assistance will also be provided to families.
Meron naman kaming emergency repatriation fund that covers it very well. $250. Ayusin lang namin na magkaroon tayo ng istahan at hanapin na namin yung pamilya nila at magpo-provide na rin tayo ng financial assistance sa pamilya.
OWA also launched an OFW tracker for Filipinos needing assistance in Sudan. Filipinos only need to visit the website sudan.owa.gov.ph and provide all the needed information, including their current location. If they move to another area, they have to update the website to alert OWA. The Philippines already raised a crisis alert to level 3 in Sudan to give way to the voluntary repatriation of Filipinos. They continue to convince those who remain in Khartoum to avail of the government's repatriation before the ceasefire ends. The DFA reiterated deployment of workers to Sudan has been banned since 2019 due to continuous clashes between warring factions battling for control over the country. Zen Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine authorities find no traces of a harmful chemical previously found at the site of a sunken oil tanker near Mindoro Oriental Province. The Philippine Environment Secretary, meanwhile, fends off criticism for her supposed absence in addressing the oil leak from the tanker. Details in this report.
Environmental damage from the Oriental Mindoro oil spill feared to reach billions of pesos. Environment Secretary Tony Yulo Loizaga told ANC some 7 billion pesos worth of marine resources are possibly exposed to the oil spill. She also says oil is still leaking from the sunken tanker.
For the DNR, we've actually calculated what could be exposed by way of coral reefs, seagrass, mangroves, and fisheries.
Okay.
And the possible exposure area for us is about 7 billion pesos. Mm-mm. What we have to do now is verify on the ground how much of these reefs have actually been touched by the oil, how many of the mangroves have actually been destroyed, how much of the seagrass has actually been affected.
The Office of Civil Defense has so far pegged the cost of damage from the oil spill at 3 billion pesos. The Environment Secretary also addressed criticisms over her supposed absence in responding to the oil spill. She asserts they were the first to act on the disaster. The DENR chief adds she was with President Marcos Jr. when he visited Oriental Mindoro on April 15th.
The first thing I'd like to say is we were first on the scene. On day one, I was already speaking with the governor. We also had a technical meeting with the Coast Guard and other parties. On day two, our teams were on the ground already testing the water and testing the air. On day three, we deployed actually the mapping ship of Namria. Why? Nobody could say where the ship had sunk. Every step of the way, we actually reported to the president.
Oriental Mindoro Governor Humerlito Dolor, meanwhile, says water sources in the towns of Nauhan and Pola have been cleared of the harmful chemical benzene. Dolor says there were no traces of the chemical in 29 water sources tested by the health department. This means residents there can again get their water supply from deep wells and other water sources near the shoreline.
A salvage team will attempt to remove a Chinese cargo vessel that ran aground last week near the Philippine province of Eastern Samar. The Philippine Coast Guard says the ship was transporting nickel ore from Homonhon Island to China. The Coast Guard is looking into reports the vessel ran aground after nearly colliding with a fishing boat.
What we did when we boarded the ship, when it was reported to us, was to check the propriety, the documents, and the documents to include the documents of the crew. And as per report of our boarding team, everything is in order, and we see no problem as regards to the seaworthiness documents and the qualification of the crew manning the ship. They were trying to evade a fishing boat. Mm-hmm. That was reported to us, and after that, because of also the strong winds, they were brought by the winds to the shallow grounds.
More legal trouble up ahead for suspended Philippine Congressman Arnolfo Teves Jr. Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla says multiple murder and frustrated murder charges may be filed against Teves next week by the National Bureau of Investigation. Remulla has tagged Teves as the main mastermind in last month's assassination of Negros Oriental Governor Roel Digamo and 8 other persons. Teves refuses to come home after getting stem cell treatment in the U.S. in February. Remulla says he's confident Philippine authorities can easily locate Teves if necessary.
We're looking at next week as the time for the filing of cases ng NBI dito sa DOJ para padadala na natin ang notice si Congressman Teves sa last known address after certification from immigration that he left the country and has not returned. So we will just give the notice at the last known address para po sa place of work, para dala yung notice para ho merong constructive notice na po sa kanya.
A Philippine court blocks the escape from the country of two former prison officials charged with the October 2022 murder of broadcaster Percy Lapid. The court in Muntinlupa City issued a hold departure order for former Corrections Bureau Chief Gerald Bantag and his deputy Ricardo Zulueta. The two men are charged with Lapid's murder and the killing of an inmate, June Villamor, who allegedly helped arrange the crime.
The Philippine National Police mulls possible criminal liability in the alleged breach of their computer database. A cybersecurity firm reported last week that over a million records of government employees and applicants were leaked online. Police Chief Information Officer Rodrigo Maranan says the PNP is looking at possible data privacy violations. But Maranan insists their computer systems were not hacked. The police anti-cybercrime group is reviewing logs from their online recruitment portal, which other agencies have tagged as the source of the data leak.
COVID deaths worldwide down by 95% since January. This was confirmed by Tedros Ghebreyesus, the chief of the World Health Organization. But he notes COVID fatalities in several countries are still rising. Ghebreyesus says 14,000 COVID-related deaths were recorded in the past 4 weeks. The WHO is urging countries to boost testing. It says this will enable accurate monitoring of the coronavirus and its mutations.
Metro Manila's COVID-19 positivity rate continues to be on an upward trend. Pandemic monitoring group OCTA says the capital region's positivity rate climbed to 12.3% this week from 8.1% last April 18. The group attributes the increase to the public's increased mobility and reduced compliance to health protocols. It also raises concern on the possible spread of the Omicron subvariant XBB.1.16, known as Arcturus. The Philippines confirmed Tuesday its first case of that Omicron subvariant in Western Visayas.
Pero para sa akin, ang pinakamalaking factor, isang panibagong subvariant ng Arcturus na na-detect na. At in fact, ako personally, may dalawa akong kilala na nagsabi sa akin na nag-positive sila for COVID at meron silang yung tinatawag na conjunctivitis or makati yung mata. Namumula yung mata, parang sore eyes, pero COVID ito yung panibagong sintomas ng yung bagong subvariant, yung Arcturus, na yun nga, yung conjunctivitis. Very unique ito dito sa Arcturus or XBB.1.16 na nanggaling ng India. Kaya masasabi ko meron siguro sila nitong Arcturus. Magkahiwalay na kakilala ko to, pero silang residing in Metro Manila. Naku. So I can say na siguro most likely kumakalat na din dito sa Metro Manila itong panibagong subvariant nito.
Philippine President Marcos Jr. acknowledges the importance of a free press amid the proliferation of fake news. He spoke Thursday evening at the 50th anniversary celebration of the country's Federation of Broadcasters, the KBP. The president noted how technological advancements and social media have contributed to the spread of misinformation. He urged the KBP to prioritize stability and objectivity to help Filipinos discern against propaganda. He also acknowledged that the Philippines sits at 147th place in the World Press Freedom Index. The president vowed to improve the present working conditions for Philippine journalists.
For its part, this government will remain committed to ensuring transparency and good governance, freedom of expression and of the press, and the protection of media practitioners and their rights in the practice of their profession. We shall work hard, hand in hand with you, to improve that present condition and climb our way up in those rankings.
Next in the news, China offers to play as peacemaker to help reach a political settlement in the Russia-Ukraine conflict.
More stories when the World Tonight returns.
We're back on The World Tonight. China's peace envoy is heading to Ukraine and other countries to act as a mediator in Russia's war in Ukraine. But some experts are skeptical of China's ability to play peacemaker. Details in this report.
Amid Russian shelling and destruction in eastern Ukraine, China surprised the world Wednesday with this announcement.
The Chinese side will send a special representative of the Chinese government on Eurasian affairs to visit Ukraine and other countries to conduct in-depth communication with all parties for a political settlement of the Ukrainian crisis.
China made several public announcements Wednesday, calling attention to its diplomatic initiative toward Ukraine, saying that Chinese leader Xi Jinping spoke with Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky. Zelensky had been asking to speak with Xi and took to Twitter to welcome the conversation. In Washington, White House National Security Council spokesperson John Kirby welcomed the news of the leaders' conversation, saying, "It's important for President Xi and PRC officials to avail themselves of the Ukrainian perspective on this illegal and unprovoked invasion by Russia." Russian Foreign Ministry spokeswoman Maria Zakharova said that Moscow sees broad concord with China's approach, but that the main obstacle is what she termed Kyiv's unrealistic demands. She visited Moscow in March. Beijing has refused to condemn Russia's invasion of Ukraine or demand withdrawal of its troops, instead calling for restraint by all parties and accusing NATO of fomenting the fighting. This leaves most foreign policy experts skeptical that China can play the peacemaker. Michael Kimmage of the Catholic University of America told VOA there was no way China was offering a useful diplomatic framework for ending this conflict.
It's going to play a role in Ukraine's reconstruction, and it's a big economic actor, and it's a major country. But it's not as if China is, for the time being and for the foreseeable future, any kind of realistic alternative to any of the actors in the war itself.
Kimmage said there are economic factors at play.
China and Ukraine had a pretty substantial economic relationship before the war. I believe that China was Ukraine's largest trading partner, and China has a network of economic interest in the region, you know, not just in Ukraine, but in the broader region.
Meanwhile, jailed Russian opposition leader Alexei Navalny said Wednesday he could face life in prison on terrorism charges, with authorities preparing a major new trial against him. Human rights organizations and Western governments are calling for his release, saying the charges against him are absurd. Cindy Sain, VOA News.
A Chinese Coast Guard ship recently confronted Philippine patrol vessels in the West Philippine Sea. The incident happened Sunday as Philippine Coast Guard boats carrying journalists patrolled the contested waterway. A collision nearly happened when a Chinese Coast Guard ship blocked the BRP Malapascua from approaching the second Thomas Shoal. The Philippine ship maneuvered to avoid hitting the Chinese vessel. The second Thomas Shoal is about 200 kilometers from the Philippine province of Palawan. A retired magazine columnist takes the stand in New York to share the details of a nearly 30-year-old rape claim against former U.S. President Donald Trump. E. Jean Carroll is seeking unspecified damages from Trump after the latter allegedly raped her in a Manhattan department store in the mid-1990s. When Carroll spoke out about the incident in 2019, Trump claimed that she was lying in a bid to bolster the sales of her forthcoming memoir. Carroll's current lawsuit is hinged on New York's Adult Survivors Act, which allows sexual abuse victims to sue for assaults that have passed the typical statute of limitations. While Trump is not expected at the trial, he has commented on the lawsuit on his social media platform Truth Social. He called the case a made-up scam and insisted that Carroll's story is fraudulent and false. The federal judge overseeing the trial warned Trump's attorney that the posts toed the line of tampering with the jury.
U.S. House Republican lawmakers defy President Biden with a bill raising the national debt ceiling with steep spending cuts. The bill presented by House Speaker Kevin McCarthy passed in a narrow 217 to 215 vote, with four Republicans voting against it. The measure calls for raising the $31.4 trillion federal debt limit by $1.5 trillion, but it also called for spending cuts three times that amount. Provisions also include rolling back some of Biden's flagship programs.
We've done our job. I've sat down with the president on February 1st. He ignored the rest of the time. He treats it just like the border. He wants to ignore it and thinks it goes away. That doesn't work in America. He's putting the American economy in jeopardy by his lack of action. Now he should sit down and negotiate. We passed this early. We are in April, way ahead of the debt limit. We are the only party to take fiscal action in a sound mind that would lift the debt limit so we wouldn't have economic damage. We've also put us back on a path to end the Washington wasteful spending and to grow our economy and make us stronger.
The White House now accusing Speaker McCarthy and House Republicans of holding the American economy hostage with a bill they passed. It said 217 lawmakers just voted to take food assistance away from hundreds of thousands of Americans, eliminate health care coverage for millions, and ship manufacturing jobs overseas, among others. The White House now calls on Congress to act immediately and without conditions to avoid a debt default.
The Walt Disney Corporation is taking Florida's Republican Governor Ron DeSantis to court. The entertainment conglomerate is suing DeSantis for allegedly weaponizing government to punish the company. Disney's row with DeSantis began last year after it criticized Florida's ban on classrooms discussions of gender identity. In February, DeSantis signed a bill stripping Disney of control of a special tax district surrounding its Walt Disney World property. Disney has since asked the court to overturn the effort. It says the governor's moves are threatening the company.
President Marcos vows consistent infrastructure projects as he led the ceremonial signing for two contracts of the North-South Commuter Railway Project. The project is a 147-kilometer railway system that seeks to connect Clark, Pampanga, and Calamba, Laguna. Marcos says the mega project will be a massive boost to the transportation system in the country as it will benefit 800,000 passengers daily.
All in all, it promises speedier transactions, more quality time, and improved quality of life for all. Imagine the comfort and convenience of traveling via a train from Clark International Airport to Calamba in just 2 hours. This is something that I still marvel at, because in my lifetime, you have never seen that. The railway will also spur economic activities in the interconnected regions and in all the areas in between. Moreover, it will promote environmental sustainability and public health.
Philippine shares close higher due to positive income reports from the banking sector. The details from Michelle Long.
Asian markets mostly down a fifth day Thursday as investors fret about regional banks and await key jobs and GDP data out of the U.S. after trading hours. This could give more clues on the Federal Reserve's next policy move happening on May 3rd. Philippine shares, though, outperforming peers, with a PSE index up 0.7% to close at 65.83.
Notable winners are the stocks in the banking sector, which are bolstered by their good earnings. Mm-hmm. Yes, we are not in the environment where everything just marches up north. We are not in a bull run yet, but there are stocks that are rallying. And seems like the market is still pretty much tradable, and that is thanks to the optimistic outlook on the first quarter earnings of the firms.
In corporate stories, a new consortium consisting of some of the country's largest conglomerates, Aboitiz Infra Capital, AC Infrastructure Holdings, Asia's Emerging Dragon, Alliance Global, PhilInvest Development, and JG Summit, together with U.S.-based global infrastructure partners, submit an unsolicited proposal for a 100 billion peso upgrade for the Nino Aquino International Airport. The proposal includes a significant upfront payment to government and committed investments in new facilities and technology to turn the airport into a world-class gateway. Kevin Tan, director of the newly formed Manila International Airport Consortium, says they are ready to put combined resources forward to partner with government in the massive undertaking, with a consortium bringing unrivaled expertise, proven solutions, and extensive capital. If the proposal materializes, it can more than double its current capacity to serve up to 62.5 million passengers per year by 2028. Back in 2018, the NAIA Super Consortium, consisting of the same conglomerates but with Manny Pangilinan, won original proponent status for the NAIA Rehab Project. That was later on shelved. Meanwhile, speaking of Manny Pangilinan, Metro Pacific Investments shares on voluntary trading suspension after disclosing it is filing for a voluntary delisting at the stock exchange. Majority shareholders, First Pacific, GT Capital Holdings, and a Mitsui-led consortium offering to buy out minority shareholders at a tender offer price of 4 pesos 63 centavos per share, representing a 22% premium, and valuing MPIC equity at 133 billion pesos. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
America's first couple capped the state visit of South Korean President Yoon Suk-yeol with a glamorous state dinner at the White House. The event celebrated the 70-year alliance of the two nations. The dinner featured musical performances, including one that received a standing ovation. The South Korean leader gave a rendition of Don McLean's song, American Pie. Have a listen.
A long, long time ago. Still remember how that music used to make me smile. And I really felt my chains, that I could make those people dance, and maybe they'd be happy for a while. A February made me shiver with the paper I deliver. Bad news on the doorstep. I couldn't have one more step. I can't remember if I tried when I read about his willow bride. Something
touched. We're still waiting for the score. Our final word tonight is a quote from John F. Kennedy. Great crises produce great men and great deeds of courage.
And that is The World Tonight, the 27th of April, 2023. I'm Pia Gutierrez.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay!